We've been in the series of messages on the book of Acts, the New Testament, which is the Holy Spirit unleashing the early followers of Jesus. And we see as the church grows, it goes through ups and downs and twists and turns. And one of the things I notice about it is that, I don't know if you picked that up, but it's not like a steady, you know, everything's getting better every day. It's like, whoa, boom, whoa, boom. things get tough following Jesus. So if you came today thinking that maybe, you know, having a relationship with Christ was going to make your life easy and trouble-free, I really hope it will be. I hope it'll be really different from everyone in the Bible. So we're up to Acts chapter 14. And Paul and Barnabas have been sent out on what's the first missionary journey. They're going from place to place, region to region, and teaching in the synagogues and preaching about the risen Lord Jesus Christ and how God came and made a difference in our world and that we can have a relationship with him and that the Holy Spirit is available to us to unleash us. That's been their message, and there's been a tremendous response wherever they go with people opening their lives up to a relationship with Christ and with people becoming outraged and trying to shut them up, basically. And so now we come to Lystra, Acts 14, verse 8. In Lystra, there sat a man who was crippled in his feet. He'd been lame from birth and had never walked. He listened to Paul, and as he was speaking, Paul looked directly at him, saw that he had faith to be healed, and called out, "Stand up on your feet," and at that the man jumped up and began to walk. When the crowd saw what Paul had done, they shouted in the Lyconian language, "The gods have come down to us in human form." Barnabas, they called Zeus, and Paul, they called Hermes, because he was the chief speaker. The priest of Zeus, whose temple was just outside the city, brought bulls and wreaths to the city gates because he and the crowd wanted to offer sacrifices to them. You know, that's like every pastor-seeking committee I ever met. That's basically the way they are at first. But when the apostles Barnabas and Paul heard this, they tore their clothes. They rushed out into the crowd shouting, "Why are you doing this? We too are only men. We're human just like you. We're bringing you good news. We're telling you to turn from these worthless things to the living God who made heaven and earth and the sea and everything in them. And in the past, he let all nations go their own way, yet he's not left himself without testimony. He's shown kindness by giving you rain from heaven and crops in their seasons, and he provides you with plenty of food and fills your heart with joy." Even with these words, they had difficulty keeping the crowd from sacrificing to them. Then some religious leaders, some Jewish leaders, came from Antioch and Iconium and won the crowd over. And so they took Paul, they stoned him, they dragged him outside the city, thinking he was dead. But after the disciples gathered around him, he got up and went back into the city. The next day, he and Barnabas left for Derbe. So Lord, teach us from this very strange experience, from this really mystifying turn of events, and show us how we might live a real life of faith and trust you wholeheartedly and not need to deify or demonize anybody. That's our need today, in Jesus' name. Amen. For most of my life, I've had a relationship with Jesus. I'm one of those people who, you know, I don't know a time when I wouldn't have said I was a Christian. I didn't have a chance because my parents were first-generation Christians in a family galaxy of pagans, basically. Everybody in our family was pagans. And then my folks wandered into a church and heard about Jesus and went, "Yeah, that's, we want to do that. We want to follow Jesus." And so us four kids had no chance. We were in Sunday school and church and Wednesday night Bible. We were at everything, you know, in youth groups and stuff. And then my parents got really extreme, and we all moved to Africa where they were missionaries. And in the jungle. And so I really had no choice. And then I came back and we settled in Whittier, California, where I went to Bethany Baptist Elementary School. And I was stuck in this. And I thought, and I'd been told since birth, that Jesus is enough. He's all you need. Put your trust in him. He'll be there for you. And your life will be abundant and full, and you'll know God. So I was taught that from an early age. But the realities of life keep creeping in. And one of the things I found is that there's a huge temptation to say, Jesus, and... if we just have this other thing along with Jesus, I'm not trying to replace Jesus in my life. I just want to have a little safety net here. Or if we could get these things worked out or that solved. Or if you ever get that thing where you go, if we just get through this, you know, then, you know, Jesus and me, we're fine. We're going through. If we just get through this. And then as soon as you get through it, you know what else you say? Well, if we get through that, then we'll be okay. There's always something else, and there's always this feeling of, well, we better, what's that? God helps those who help themselves. What verse was that? Oh, that was Ben Franklin. Yeah, that wasn't in the Bible. Okay. But there's a long time, deep history in Christendom of wanting to have something besides just a relationship with Christ. Somehow we're afraid that it's not enough, and we want it to be enough. Now, in this passage, we see this amazing experience where they go in to preach, and the response of the people, particularly when they see this healing of the person who had not walked in his whole life, they immediately go, oh my golly, the gods have come here. Not just any gods either. I mean, you know, in the pantheon of gods, these were big ones. You know, Zeus, I mean, my gosh. I wish I was Barnabas because he was Zeus, you know, to them, you know. Hermes, they just called him Hermes. They called that because he could speak real well and stuff. And so they thought, well, he's the lesser god. So I wonder, why would they go to that? You know, I mean, that's such a weird thing. And some historians have pointed out that actually in the there's a mythology, Greek mythology, there's a story about how Zeus and Hermes come to this region disguised as humans. Whoa, no one recognized it. And they come in, except that they were treated really poorly, they weren't welcomed, and they weren't treated good, and they were set aside. And as retaliation, everyone in the region, except for this one old couple, and I don't know what their names are, Philemon and Bacchus, it's one old couple. They were the only ones who were good to Zeus and Hermes in disguise. And so everybody drowned in the whole region except this one couple, and they were made the guardians of the temple, just outside of the town. So that was the mythology. And so you can understand the people thinking, we're not going to let that happen again, right? Forget that. And so when they see something extraordinary in their midst, and these strangers come into town, and something happens, and they're hearing them speak everything, and they go, oh my golly, this is it again. Only this time we're going to do it right. It's Zeus and Hermes. They're gods. Let's acknowledge them and welcome them and celebrate them and worship them as the gods that they are. So that makes sense, right? It's not like crazy response. It's a safekeeping. And so they go to do this. And, you know, there is a tendency among us, even to this day, maybe we don't call them Zeus or Hermes or something like that, but there's a tendency with leaders. It doesn't matter if it's political or church or business leaders or celebrities. And we want them to be special. We want them to be not like us. And throughout most of my life, as pastors, there's this tendency in some churches to put the pastor up on a pedestal. You want them to be perfect. You want them to have all this faith, and you want everything to work really well for them, because that means that it's going to work well for you too, And so there's this tendency of whatever happens, make sure the pastor's heroic. Now, I didn't get that genetic link. I didn't get that message either. And so my deal was always, whatever story I tell, make sure I'm not the hero. Make sure I'm the one who didn't understand and I got it wrong and all that stuff. Which, I got to tell you this, over the years, particularly in the really large churches, that frustrated the stew out of people. There were people who were deeply grieved that I wasn't heroic. And one of the things that I experienced it, but when we don't get what we want from someone, it's real easy to turn and demonize them. They're the problem. I had one couple, they came to the church in California. They loved me. And one Sunday after worship, they came up with a box. I opened it up and it was socks. And I'm standing in the aisle going, well, thank you. I have some. Many of them match. What's this gift? And they said, oh, Pastor, ever since we come to this church, you knock our socks off. Okay. And we got to be friends. I got in a small group with them. Something happened. She applied for a job at the church and didn't get it. And I became Satan. I was like the physical embodiment of evil. And it got really bad fast. I should look at those socks more often. That's more positive. But that happens, and you just go, oh, here's the problem. And it turns really quickly. As it turned for Paul and Barnabas. Here they are. They're being celebrated and honored and deified, and the people are going to worship them. And when they say, no, we're just human. We're just like you. We're no different. But we want to tell you about this amazing God who loves you, who cares for you, and who is really helping us with our issues, is really making a difference in our stuff. We're just like you, except that as Christ lives in us, we're experiencing forgiveness and his love and care, and we're empowered to go forward, and we want you to have this too. Now, this wasn't the first time this happened. You go way back in the Bible. Elijah, the prophet, he gathers the people together, and they're having this tension because the fertility god, the Baal worshippers, we're not going to have crops, we're not going to have rain, we're not going to have anything if we don't be faithful to the fertility gods. And meanwhile, the God of heaven and earth is saying, trust me alone. And so Elijah gathers the people together and says, how long are you going to hobble between two opinions? If God is God, worship him. If Baal's God, worship him. Make up your mind. Because it's so easy to want to just take a little of this, a little of that, a little of the other, and just to protect ourselves. And so it's interesting that the message that Paul gives to them in the midst of all this is, God has shown kindness. He gives you the rain from heaven. He gives you the crops. You don't need to have a fertility God. You don't need to have other gods. He's going to give you rain. He's going to give you your crops. And he provides you with plenty of food. You don't have to worry about that. He fills your hearts with joy. God will do everything that you need. He'll take care of you. He'll love you. He'll show you his love. He'll fill you with joy. You can have all of that. And when they hear that, they just go ballistic. And they turn, and suddenly, instead of being gods, they're now monsters, right? They turn, and they want to kill them. And so, they stone Paul till they think he's dead. And then they drag his body out of the city to the garbage heap, and they dump it there and leave his dead body there. Because why? He would be what they wanted him to be. Now, you know, trust me, I got control issues. You all know that. Whoa, you know it better than most. Not as well as Eileen and Damien, but better than most, you know. And I've got control issues. But one of the things that we found, there's a tendency to want to control the gospel. There's a tendency to want to control Christ. And so we by putting our focus on the messenger, we can keep the message from really impacting us. If we can say, you know, I go to that church over there, and you know, I don't like the way the pastor combs his hair, and it's kind of irritating the way he pronounces certain words. He mispronunciates them, you know what I'm saying. And you come out and you go, so what was the message? I don't know. So focused on other stuff. And that happens all the time. And we can try and keep God under our control if we focus on the messenger, or we focus on other things, and focus on what we need with Jesus' hand, and we keep all these things in order, and we're in control. I mean, over the years, I've known churches all over the country, and a lot of pastors, and it's really funny because I had a friend who was a senior pastor of this huge church in the just outside of Denver, and he said that 14 years there, he and his wife decided this is such a wonderful place for us, and our ministry is so good. There were like, I don't know, 3,000 people in the church, and so we decided we were going to just live this out the rest of our life, and this was going to be the one place that we serve, and we love these people, and they love us, and so they designed and built their dream home. In the 15th year, some uprising happened in the church, and suddenly the congregation, the leadership, thought that he couldn't preach, he couldn't teach, he was not a good leader, he had no skills, so his marriage seemed troubled, and so they drove him out. 1 year after building their dream home. I told Eileen, whatever you do, never get a dream home, okay? Make it a work in progress. And I was talking to him, and he said it was the weirdest thing, because we had all these years, everything was great, and then suddenly it just was not just mediocre, it was awful. And that happens over and over again. And usually the congregation says things to them like, well, it wasn't a good fit. And you think about it, what is that message? It's not a good fit. That means, you know, if the message doesn't fit what we want, if the ministry doesn't fit our style, if the vision is not fitting into what we want to have happen, if God is asking something of us that we really don't want to do, that doesn't really fit with us, and maybe the needs are too great and we don't want to, it doesn't really fit what we want to do. And all of a sudden you go, whoa, how come the standard is what fits us? That's an extreme control of the gospel. And so, obviously, Barnabas and Paul were not a good fit. So they've got to be stoned and killed and dragged out of the city and left on the garbage dump. Now, you'd think the story would end there. If I was writing it, it probably would. I'd go, see, that's what happens. But instead it says, after the disciples had gathered around Paul's body, He got up and went back into the city. And the next day, he and Barnabas left for Derbe. He wasn't dead, like they thought. They hadn't killed him. They hadn't silenced him. And they hadn't stopped the gospel from going out. When I first read that, I thought about what disciples gathered around him. I thought that Paul and Barnabas were just out there by themselves. Well, evidently, some people in Lystra heard the message. They got it. And they opened their life up to a relationship with Christ. And we find out later in the New Testament that two people, Eunice and Lois, both began their relationship with Christ. They started following Jesus during this time in Lystra. And they're mentioned later on in the New Testament. But Lois's son, probably about 14 years old at the time, was named Timothy. And he was Eunice's grandson. And he might have been one of the ones standing there around Paul's seemingly dead body in the garbage heap as a 14-year-old kid. And he's the one that Paul said, don't let them look down on you because of your youthfulness, because of your age. Be bold. And he says, Paul says to Timothy, we met at this time. God didn't give us a spirit of timidity, but of power and self-control. That all happened at the same time. So while some people are turning away considering Paul and Barnabas monsters because they can't control the message, they don't want someone who's not a God, they don't want another human being here sharing how God can make a difference in their life and we're all the same, they didn't want to hear that, but some people did, and it changed their life, and it changed the church for centuries. So what do we do with this? What do we do with this? It could be just an eccentric thing, but maybe not. I think that it's an important reminder to us that it's not Jesus and. We don't need to mix and match different ways to cover ourselves, protect ourselves. We don't need to control God, and we don't need to control the message so that it's only the way that fits for us. We could actually allow Jesus to come into our life and transform us instead of us shaping him. Wouldn't that be cool? We could let Jesus come into our church and change us as a church from the inside, rather than trying to get the Bible to line up with how we want our church to be. Wouldn't that be weird? We could actually be really human together, have real issues, and learn to love and care for each other the way we are after this point, believing that God's not done with us yet, and that we've got a ways to go, and that we can encourage each other as the Lord loves us into the person we're becoming. Wouldn't that be amazing? We can set aside our preconceived ideas of how things ought to be and what should happen and what should things should sound like, all these things, and allow God to just have his way with us. What if that was our prayer? Have your way with us. Well, whatever happens, I love that when the followers of Jesus gathered around Paul in the garbage heap, thinking he was dead, he wasn't, and he got up, and instead of running for his life, what did he do? He went back into the city, where they had just stoned him and dragged him out and left him for dead. He went back in. I love that. And then he and Barnabas went on with their mission trip. They weren't done yet. They traveled on together to the next town. I think God's not done with us yet. And you may feel like you've been dragged out to the dump somewhere and left. You may feel that way today. You may feel like, wow, I got nothing left here, boom. It's time to get up and go back in. You may think that, you know, God's done with you. You've had, you know, your life's sort of, it's over now. You just, you know, rest on, some people rest on their laurels. You can rest on your garbage heap. Or you can get up and go back in. I think that's what he wants us to do. Just go back in.